Hello, and welcome to our new series, The Christian Literary Imagination. I'm joined today with by Joseph Simmons from Campion Hall, who's my joint convener. This is the first event in this series, and it takes over from Christian Shakespeare question mark, which we had last year. And as last year, it's sponsored by Georgetown University in association with Las Casas Institute, Blackfriars Hall at the University of Oxford. Throughout, we'll be joined over the academic year by eminent speakers who have chosen their own title and their own author to look at the meaning or our understanding of this term, the Christian literary imagination. We encourage you to participate, please, within these events by typing in your questions to the respective speakers. And you can do that by going to your Q&A button at the bottom of your screen and typing it in from now on, from the beginning of the event to the end of the event. And we'll try and put those questions to people towards the end. And if we can't do that, then we'll actually send them emails and we ask them if they'll reply to you by email. Today's event is a little different from the other events that we're going to have because we've got two speakers. We've got me. I'm going to start off by trying to map out the territory of this series from the medieval period to the Romantics. And then I'm going to hand over to Joe Simmons, who then is going to take it from the Romantics to the present day. The series is part of a larger project, as was last year's, promoted by Las Casas Institute and Georgetown University's Humanities Initiative, and it's called The Future of the Humanities. The aim of that project is through a series of high-profile events, conferences, talks, lectures, seminars, and so forth, that we are able to promote the humanities in the development of the individual and the development of society. And within that, we're promoting human dignity, equality, and culture. And we have a range of various speakers doing that through the year with this series and with other series. For those who don't know me, I'm the Senior Dean and Fellow at Blackfriars Hall. And Joe is an ordained Jesuit priest from the USA, where he studied at Boston College for his licentiate in sacred theology. And he's presently studying in Oxford, where he's completing his doctorate at Campion Hall. And he will be giving the second of the two talks. So let me begin. In considering what we mean by the Christian literary imagination, both Joe Simmons in his thesis for his licentiate in theology at Boston College, and also Lucy Beckett in a book called In the Light of Christ, Writings in the Western Tradition, and other people have looked back to Samuel Coleridge's definition of primary and secondary imagination. Coleridge is a bit convoluted in what he says, so I'm going to read it to you now, and then I'll tell you what I think it means. He says about the primary imagination, the living power and prime agent of all human perception, and as a reception in the finite mind of the eternal act of creation in the infinite I am. That is the primary. And the secondary is as an echo of the former, coexisting with the conscious will, yet still as identical with the primary in the kin of its agency, and differing only in degree and in the mode of its operation. Now, I hope you're still with me and that you haven't decided that you're so bored you're going to walk out, because what that means, I think, is it refers to his belief that forms of imaginative creativity in humans reflect the creativity of God, the creator of all things. God, the creator of everything, works through us in the creative acts in which we engage. Now, Coleridge goes on to say, religion passes out of the ken of reason only where the eye of reason has reached its own horizon. I'm reading from Coleridge. And faith is then but its continuation to preserve the soul steady and collected in its pure act of inward adoration to the great I am and to the filial word that reaffirmeth it from eternity to eternity, whose call echo is the universe. In this, Coleridge appears to be in revolt against the previous age of the Enlightenment, in which reason had dominated thought, all our perception. He's referring to his belief that reason and religion can only go so far together to the point where reason can go no further. Religion, however, through belief, which sustains us through prayer and to adoration of God and his Son, takes us further. God and his Son speak as one to each other, which is creation itself. Well, what we want to do in this series is to see how an eclectic variety of writers are consciously or unconsciously operating within a bounds of faith, which goes further than reason through the imagination tempered by Christianity. And I will order my comments today in a roughly chronological way, from the medieval to the romantics, and then I'll hand over to Joe. But the talks throughout the series are going to be determined by the availability of our contributors, and therefore can't actually be in a chronological order. So let me go to the medieval writers. The Christian literary imagination was consciously expressed through the morality and the mystery plays, the latter of which were based on the central mystery of the Catholic faith, which is found in the liturgy of the Mass. This has a central theme of the birth, death, and resurrection of Christ. Whilst the medieval divines tried to explain this mystery of faith through reason, as, for example, determining transubstantiation and so on and so forth, the local people in their crafts, in their craft guilds, enacted the mystery through appropriate biblical stories that conveyed the redemption of mankind through Christ's birth, crucifixion, and resurrection. So they did this in terms of plays which they took from the Bible, but they took it in a liturgical way. So they didn't just take any biblical stories. They didn't take Daniel in the lion's den. They didn't take Joshua at the Battle of Jericho. They took stories which were liturgically important to demonstrate what happens in terms of the Mass, which is the sacrifice of Christ, a representation of the sacrifice of Christ on Calvary. Some 15th century poets, of course, similarly expressed their faith in lyrical poetry, such as this one, which is called Woefully Arrayed. And I will read this to you. Woefully arrayed, my blood a man for thee ran, it may not be nayed, my body blow and wan, woefully arrayed. The lyrics describe Christ hanging on the cross, humiliated, afflicted, his woeful body, his woeful appearance, suffering from torture and the degrading means of his death. This is taken further in another similar play, similar poem called The Wells of Jesus' Wounds, which take that image and relates it to those who view it to their imagination. Here I read again. Jesus' wounds so wide, been wells of life to the good, namely the strand of his side that ran full bream on the root. If thee list to drink, to flee fro the fangs of hell, bow thou down to the brink and meekly taste of the well. Here we have the wounds producing streams of blood through Christ's death on the cross, which form wells, which give eternal life to those who are virtuous. They should bow down and they meekly should taste the blood in order to be saved. The imagination is therefore working in two ways. The first example, it evokes the depiction of the crucified Christ, and in the second, the need for active participation in the death and resurrection by the faithful tasting of his blood, which will bring salvation from the fiends of hell. In the medieval morality plays, a different type of play, the Castle of Perseverance, Mankind, and Mundus et Infans are examples. The tenets of religion are acted out. These are overtly battle plays in which the devil and his horde wage war with the angels of God for that imaginative reality or aspect of mankind, which is called the soul. They either fight, and in the Castle of Perseverance, they actually do fight. They go and fight on a field to drag man towards hell or to bring him back towards heaven. And or they try to connive and hoodwink mankind, the mankind figure, to come to hell. But they never win. And the reason why they never win is because Christ died for the whole of mankind. So they are the representatives, the actors are the representatives of the whole of mankind. That's an important point, because that's going to change. The play Everyman is also a variant, because in that play, you have the Everyman figure personifying all mankind, who gradually loses all his senses, all his goods, everything he knows in the process of death. And the message is given in the epilogue, and it's quite clear. And the message is, and I read again, "For after death amends may no man make, for then mercy and pity doth him forsake, if his reckoning be not clear when he doth come. God will say, ite maledicte in egnum eternum," which means go wicked ones to the everlasting fire. And then they say, "And he that hath his account whole and sound high in heaven shall be crowned." So it is an overtly didactic play working on the imagination, but a didactic play. Everyman is a play of death and the reality of death, and then the meeting with God and going to heaven or to hell. Now that is secularized in the Shakespearean age, where the imagination moves from the collective representation of all mankind or every man to a concentration on the individual protagonist, such as Dr. Faustus or Macbeth. In Marlowe's Dr. Faustus, 1592, Shakespeare's Macbeth, 1606, and Middleton and Rowley's The Changeling, 1622, the central characters choose what is seen to be as evil, whatever the consequences. It is a rebellion of the creative imagination, in the creative imagination, looking at the bad rather than looking at the good. And that means that Dr. Faustus can actually, at the end, be taken to hell because he's now an individual. In our series, Paul Edmondson was to speak in a couple of weeks' time, but unfortunately, illness in his family can't allow that, so he's postponed. But he will be speaking on Shakespeare on the 16th of March, 2021. On the 8th of December, John Dukakis from the University of Stirling, Scotland, will give an illustration of the imaginative consequences of the rebellion against faith with a talk on Cyril Turner's great play, The Atheist Tragedy. In the age of Shakespeare, the Christian imagination becomes tied up with the politics of the English Reformation, but we find wonderful descriptive and devout Christian poems by such poets as Spenser, Southall, Donne, Herbert, Drayton, Drummond, and many others. And as an example, Claire Asquith has chosen to talk about Michael Drayton's Fair Matilda poems on the 9th of February, 2021. Here, let me just mention a poem by Robert Southwell. He was a Jesuit priest, and he wrote a poem called The Burning Babe, about which the playwright Ben Jonson said he would have given up some of his greatest works to have written this poem. Now, I'm not going to read that to you today, because on the 27th of October, replacing Paul Edmondson, Peter Davidson from Campion Hall will be talking about Southwell, and I'm really looking forward to that lecture on that day. The Jesuit Southwell was later, after such beautiful poems, was later to be horrifically executed for his Catholicism at a time when throughout Europe, Christians legally executed one religious persuasion or another of Christianity, depending on the dominant variant as followed by the ruling monarch. The Christian imagination in this respect was not always Christian. In England, the ultra-Protestant cause gained the upper hand through the civil war between the Puritan Roundheads and the Royalists of the English Church, which had retained its bishops. But within that turmoil, one of England's most accomplished poets, John Milton, appeared. I'm pleased to say that on the 9th of March 2021, one of the world's leading authorities on Milton, Professor Noel Sugimura from St. John's College, Oxford, but formerly at Georgetown, will be treating us to a talk on the poet. If we ever needed an example of the height of the Christian literary imagination and the mastery of English verse, we can hardly do better than go to the opening book of the opening of book four of Paradise Lost. Please note that this that I'm going to quote from goes on in a single sentence to halfway through line 23, and even some will say, depending on the editor, to line 26. The power of Christian literary imagination in describing Satan's voyage to earth to destroy mankind by tempting Adam and Eve is evident in the dexterity of the verse, the energy of the description, and the psychology of the satanic character. So let me just read that to you. Oh, for that warning voice, which he who saw the apocalypse heard cry in heaven aloud. Then, when the dragon, put to second rout, came furious down to be revenged on men, woe to the inhabitants on earth, that now, while time was, our first parents had been warned the coming of their secret foe, and scaped, happily so scaped his mortal snare. For now, Satan, now first inflamed with rage, came down, the tempter, ere the accuser of mankind, to wreak on innocent frail man his loss of that first battle and his flight to hell. Yet not rejoicing in his speed, though bold far off and fearless, nor without cause to boast, begins his dire attempt, which neither birth, now rolling, boils in his tumultuous breast, and like a devilish engine, back recoils upon himself. Horror and doubt distract his troubled thoughts, and from the bottom stir the hell within him. For within him hell he brings, and round about him, nor from hell one step no more than from himself can fly by change of place. Now, conscience wakes despair that slumbered, wakes the bitter memory of what he was, what is, and what must be worse, of worse deeds, worse sufferings must ensue. Sometimes towards Eden, which now in his view lay pleasant, his grieved look he fixes sad. Sometimes towards heaven and the full blazing sun, which now sat high in his meridian tower, then much revolving, thus in sighs began. By line 74, the psychology of sin has totally enveloped Satan as he reflects. Me miserable, which way shall I fly? Infinite wrath and infinite despair. Which way I fly is hell. Myself am hell. One aspect of the Christian literary imagination is that it is able vividly to create portraits of sin, anger, despondency, violence, and evil. On the 23rd of February 2021, Mark Bosco from Georgetown will discuss the contemporary work of Flannery O'Connor, although he would have also liked to have spoken about the novels of Graham Greene, but perhaps we'll have that at a later date. In the 18th century, Christopher Smart, 1722 to 1771, wrote a remarkable but relatively little known religious poem called Jubilate Agno, Rejoice in the Lamb, whilst he was confined to a home for the insane. It will be discussed by Molly Clark from Merton College, Oxford, on the 27th of November 2020, in what should prove a fascinating talk, perhaps touching on this horizon where reason can take us no further. It was during the Romantic Age that Coleridge gave us his definition of the Christian literary imagination. We find this in his imaginative poetry and in the work of William Wordsworth, his friend. They seem to spar off one another in thought and expressive poetry. However, it is at the start of the Romantic period that we find many of the enigmatic poems concerning religion, the advent of the Industrial Revolution, the nature of creation itself, in the poems of William Blake, as testified by the tiger, which I'll read. Tiger, tiger, burning bright in the forests of the night, what immortal hand or eye could frame thy fearful symmetry? In what distant deeps or skies burnt the fire of thine eyes? On what wings dare he aspire? What the hand dare seize the fire? And what shoulder and what art could twist the sinews of thy heart? And when thy heart began to beat, what dread hand and what dread feet? What the hammer, what the chain? In what furnace was thy brain? What the anvil, what dread gasp dare its deadly terrors clasp? When the stars threw down their spears and watered heaven with their tears, did he smile his work to see? Did he who made the lamb make thee? Tiger, tiger, burning bright in the forests of the night, what immortal hand or eye dare frame thy fearful symmetry? But now I'm starting to encroach on Joe Simmons' area. But please note, however, that on the 10th of November, Michael Collins will be talking about the complex yet rewarding 19th century priest and poet Gerard Manley Hopkins, 1844 to 1889. But how can I resist the indulgence of reading the opening stanza of his great poem, The Wreck of the Deutschland, to show the Christian imagination at work? Thou mastering me, God, giver of breath and bread, world strands, sway of the sea, Lord of living and dead, thou hast bound bones and veins in me, fasten me flesh, and after it almost unmade, what with dread thy doing? And dost thou touch me afresh? Over again I feel thy finger and find thee. Over again I feel thy finger and find thee. That, for me, is partly what the Christian literary imagination is all about. And so now I'm going to pass over to Joe to take it on a little bit further. Over to you, Joe.
Thank you, Michael, and thank you all of us joining us around the world, wherever you might be. This might feel like we're roller skating through the Louvre here, but we're trying to give sort of an overview of the Christian literary imagination as it's developed. And Michael has touched on some of those luminary figures of Christian poetry and fiction. And you will no doubt agree that there are as many possible subjects as there are days in the year, maybe even days in a lifetime, and we can't cover everything. But I think this series of lectures and discussions is a modest attempt to hit some of the main targets. Some of them are well known and some who will merit our speculation and consideration. Today, I want to propose and attempt a modest answer to the question, what is the Christian literary imagination, and what place can modernist writers, that is to say, picking up after the Romantic period, what place can romantic or modern artists, even agnostic or atheist writers, have in the Christian literary imagination? We've said we'd like to identify the Christian literary imagination. and the variety of topics we'll be treating this year reveals that it is a hard concept to define. But for a first basic stab at a definition, I rely on the understanding of the Christian imagination from the 20th century American Jesuit, William Lynch. In his book, Christ and Apollo, pictured here, Lynch defines a properly Christian imagination as one that takes seriously the thisness of concrete details, the hyseity, which Gerard Manley Hopkins himself focused on, and which Don Scotus and earlier people in the medieval period focused on. The thisness of concrete details, just as Christ himself did. Christ, who didn't take flights of fancy that we'd expect from people the likes of Apollo. It doesn't settle for abstractions that would flatten out differences of experience, which Lynch would term a univocal or kind of a flattened approach to reality. And the opposite temptation that Lynch points out is that we are all different and cannot speak to one another and are forever alone and mutually unknowable. That is what he calls the equivocal imagination, each of us a Superman alone in our fortress of solitude. So the only hope for us in the Christian imagination is an analogical imagination, where we can read the particulars of another person's story at a different time, a different culture, in a different language, and find some common resonance, some analogy across that difference. Another important point that we can take from Lynch, I think, is that Christ-like engagement with particulars doesn't mean that the Christian imagination is always talking about Jesus. It means that such an engagement is patterned on the exit and return of the God-man Christ in the incarnation. What the scholastics would talk about is the exitus and reditus, the exit and return of God coming down in the person of Jesus. And so a properly Christian imagination has a similar double movement. The first is to move down and take seriously the concrete particulars of our humanity, all of the psycho-emotional subtleties of interiority, but it also offers a vision of how life exists above and beyond human subjectivity and inwardness. It engages the nitty-gritty of human experience, questions of faith and of doubt, giving what the New Yorker reviewer James Wood calls lifeness, believability, because an attempt is made from the real questions that people have, people who believe in God or don't, whether they are Christian or not. One may think of the literary strictly in terms of a writer or a reader of books and the written material that binds them together for a few hours every day. But to broaden that definition of the literary, I take what the professor of English at the University of Liverpool, Philip Davis, has to say in his little book, Reading and the Reader, about the qualifier literary. Davis writes that the literary is not restricted to the practitioner in writing or even the academic who does the studying. It exists in the whole range of the world, which is its subject matter. It consists in what non-writers actively receive from writings when, for example, they start to see the world more imaginatively as a result of reading novels. That the literary is when people start to see the world more imaginatively as a result of reading novels and begin to think more carefully about human personality, end quote. All of this happens, Davis reasons, because literature, quote, makes available much of human life that would not otherwise be existent or thought or recognizable as knowledge. As Davis sees it, the literary then is a way of making conscious, of thematizing, of giving language to the ways we interact with the worlds, both inside and outside of our head, long after we set down a piece of fiction. Now, given the limits of time, I want to speak today about two agnostic English writers who are masters of capturing interiority, people that I'm writing about in my own doctoral dissertation, my thesis right now. And those writers are Julian Barnes and Virginia Woolf. By contrast, at the end, I'll briefly mention the American Calvinist writer Marilynne Robinson, who is very clear about her religious beliefs, while also a master of human interiority and concrete experience. But before we delve into these writers, I want to begin by taking a little imaginative stroll through Catalonia. Join me, won't you, since none of us is getting on a plane anytime soon. You may have visited La Sagrada Familia in Barcelona. It's a strange, beautiful church that has been under construction continuously, nearly continuously, since 1882. It's a basilica dedicated to God, mediated by the beauty of mathematics and nature. Like a pair of trousers turned inside out, the theological stitchwork is on the outside, and the outside world of trees and light populate the interior. There is little interior theological decoration, The altar is covered, as you can see, by a suspended baldacchino dotted with small lamps. On the walls, a few helical staircases and futuristic elevators whiz up and down. And colored windows line the length of the church and circle through the year's seasons as one moves first down and then back up the length of the nave. When he was asked about the interior, he defended his choice because it's stark white. And Gaudí, the designer, said, "Well, let God paint the inside." Anyone who has been in to see the light filtering through the stained glass knows what Gaudí's vision was all about. The basilica's pitched columns thin out as they shoot upwards. They look like tree trunks that rifle upwards into helicoidal patterns. Gaudí's vision for these star-shaped pillars was to reflect angels descending and ascending between heaven and earth, an exitus followed by a reditus, an imaginative movement hewn in stone and geometry. The columns smooth and taper into ellipsoidal capitals that resemble bitten coconuts or pineapples. And that fruit in turn grounds asymmetrical branches that support the roof and the towers like a dense forest canopy. Now, Antoni Gaudí was a contemporary of the modernist poet Joan Maragall, who lived from 1860 to 1911. He was an important pillar of Catalan culture at the end of the 19th century, and records show that both he and Gaudí knew one another. Both of these men were also fascinated by a cathedral-like grove of tall beech trees in the region called La Garrocha, a region in Catalonia known for its unusually volcanic, fertile soil. In a poem that he wrote called La Fageda de Enjordà, Maragall lingers beneath the towering trees in La Garrocha, where natural beauty draws his mind upward. I'll read the poem in English because I don't know about you, but I don't speak much Catalan. He goes, "Do you know where the beech grove of Jordà is? If you go for the flights of Olot, above the plain, you will find a place that is green and deep as never before has been found by anybody else in the world. Green like in water profound and clear, the green of beechwood in Jordà. The stroller, when he enters this place, begins to walk slowly. He counts his steps in the great stillness. He stops and he feels nothing and he is lost. He stops and he feels nothing and he is lost." Maragall had a complex relationship with his family's Catholic faith. He was pious as a youth, but he rejected formal religion in adolescence, finding Christian language insufficient to the task of expressing his religious experience. As an adult poet, he settled into a romantic pantheism, translating Nietzsche into Catalan and celebrating the power of beauty and nature, something familiar in the Romantic period moving into modernism. Which brings us to our topic today. We find a similar exitus from religious faith in post-Christian or expressly atheist cultures and the writers that might be producing them. Now, there are innumerable modern examples that we can think of in the Anglosphere, Philip Pullman or Ian McEwan or Ayn Rand, to name just a few. But because of time today, as I said, I only want to mention two, Julian Barnes and Virginia Woolf. Julian Barnes' 2008 Meditation on Death, Nothing to be Frightened of, begins with a memorable jolt. He says, "I don't believe in God, but I miss him." This is no mere story of nostalgic subtraction, though. He writes in it, "I had no faith to lose. I was never baptized, never sent to Sunday school. I've never been to a normal church service in my life. I'm constantly going into churches, but for architectural reasons, and more widely, to get a sense of what Englishness once was." Barnes recognizes God's absence through the pains of aesthetic withdrawal, like the caffeine addict detecting the brain prickings of not getting his morning rush of coffee. Barnes continues, "I miss the God that inspired Italian painting and French stained glass, German music and English chapter houses, and those tumble-down heaps of stone on Celtic headlands, which were once symbolic beacons in the darkness and in the storm." In essays and fiction alike, Barnes cannot stop talking about God, in the sense of talking around the God whose absence bothers him, if only as a cultural linchpin. These works of art that he refers to, this music and these landscapes, they point out a terrain that he knows or feels like he once knew. As Barnes mourns his wife's early death, he is faced with his own mortal contingency. "God might be dead," he says, "but death is well alive. God, bye." He has bidden adieu, adieu. he cannot help but address the divine lacuna left by the bothersome deity in whom he cannot believe. What I argue about in my thesis is that folks like him are speaking about God after God is quite literally, or that they're speaking about God in the sense of Kirkham or Perry, tiptoeing around the perimeter, careful not to fall into the abyss of credulous deception and belief. The God whose absence is felt becomes present again, what a philosopher Richard Carney at Boston College calls anatheism, ana, a return to God, or God beyond atheism. For Barnes, as for Virginia Woolf, God appears as a phantasm, as if from a bad dream. Virginia Woolf's highly autobiographical novel, To the Lighthouse, is haunted by vestiges of the divine, despite the fact that, as Woolf wrote in a letter to her sister, there's something obscene in a living person sitting by the fire and believing in God. She was referring to T.S. Eliot in his conversion to Anglo-Catholicism. The novel's protagonist, Mrs. Ramsay, is regularly drawn first inward and then outward, attuned to the rhythms of life in the natural world. Mrs. Ramsay discovers what I call in my thesis a consonant concrescence, an attuned melding of inner and outer worlds. And in this liminal space, divine utterances occur to her unbidden. She appears to be, in a word, haunted by a non-existent deity who interrupts her interiority. Let's consider an example from early in the text. Mrs. Ramsay sits by the window overlooking the sea. She hears waves rhythmically wafting in through the window. She writes, "The gruff murmur, this sound which had lasted now half an hour and had taken its place soothingly, so that the monotonous fall of the waves on the beach, which for the most part beat a measured and soothing tattoo to her thoughts, and seemed consoling to repeat over and over again, as she sat with the children, the words of, some old cradle song, murmured by nature, I am guarding you, I am guarding you, I am your support. But at other times, suddenly and unexpectedly, the waves had no such kindly meaning, but like a ghostly roll of drums remorselessly beat the measure of life." Mrs. Ramsay grows attuned to the susurrus of deeper reality with a numinous voice offering, I am guarding you, I am your support. But then she snaps out of the trance. Her mind is struck by a ghostly roll of drums remorselessly beating out the measure of life. The promise, perhaps the empty promise of a consoling God, gives way to a hollow death announcing itself. She is torn between an absent presence and a present absence. Woolf is the master of introspective tunneling. Several chapters later, Mrs. Ramsay turns her gaze inward again after putting her children to sleep. And in the rarefied silence that she enjoys, Mrs. Ramsay, quote, could be herself by herself. To think, well, not even to think, to be silent, to be alone. All of the being and the doing, expansive, glittering, vocal, evaporated. One shrunk with a sense of solemnity to being oneself, a wedge-shaped core of darkness, something invisible to others. This wedge-shaped core of darkness, to me, evokes John of the Cross's poem Noche Oscura, Dark Night. San Juan de la Cruz writes of a similar interior movement undertaken alone and in the darkness. He writes, on a dark night, I went forth without being observed, my house being now at rest. In darkness and secure by the secret ladder disguised, oh happy chance, in darkness and in concealment, my house being now at rest. Mrs. Ramsay in Woolf's novel sinks into her core of darkness. In this space, Woolf writes, it is all dark, it is all spreading, it is unfathomably deep. But now and again we rise to the surface, and that is what you see us by. Her horizon seemed limitless, and to everybody there was always the sense of unlimited resources, she supposed. In Mrs. Ramsay's interior descent, she encounters an unthematized and unconscious horizon of unlimited resources, which feeds her imagination. Woolf writes, there were all of the places she had not seen, the Indian plains. She felt herself pushing aside the thick leather curtain of a church in Rome. This core of darkness could go anywhere, for no one saw it. This core of darkness, Woolf intimates, is where Mrs. Ramsay engages fantastic encounters with the world beyond her little corner of Scotland. Woolf captures something of what Jared Manley Hopkins senses in his deep down life from his poem, God's Grandeur. And for all of this, nature is never spent. there lives the dearest freshness, deep down things. Wolfe describes such a horizon wherein she engages authentic thinking and imagination. In a later excerpt, she is staring out at the lighthouse and Mrs. Ramsay becomes mesmerized. Mrs. Ramsay finds that the lighthouse stroke of light speaks to her as if a divine address. The light would lift up on it some little phrase or other which had been lying in her mind like that. Children don't forget, children don't forget, which she would repeat and begin adding to it. It will end, she said. It will come, when suddenly she added, we are in the hands of the Lord. Mrs. Ramsay is startled that religious words, we are in the hands of the Lord, should emerge from deep from her consciousness. What might the source of thoughts of divine protection be for Mrs. Ramsay? Mere childish rhymes? Soothing lies? By virtue of the free indirect style, Wolfe deftly refrains from landing either on reliable religious belief or in atheism. Rather, she acknowledges the irritation felt at being trapped in the mawkish afterglow of religious belief. But such a thought occurs nonetheless, as she, and as Virginia Woolf, remains what I call bothered by God, considering the particularities and curiosities of what goes on in the worlds within one's head. This, friends, too, is engaging the Christian literary imagination. Marilyn Robinson is one of the other primary interlocutors of my doctoral thesis. If I had more time, I would give a full account of her theological worldview. But suffice it to say that in both her fiction and her essays, Robinson is bothered by God and by the limits of language to capture mystery. Yet Robinson writes from a position of belief. She says that our limits of language, demonstrations of the failures of language are paradoxically demonstrations of the extraordinary power of language to evoke a reality beyond its grasp, to evoke the sense of what cannot be said. We find in this echoes of what Coleridge offered in Michael Scott's opening remarks about reason revealing its limits to itself, and after that, faith takes over. Robinson is drawn beyond the visible world precisely by her desire and her inability to articulate perfectly what lies beyond our grasp. She writes in an essay, "We live on a little island of the articulable, which we tend to mistake for reality itself. We can and do make small and tedious lives as we sail through the cosmos on our uncannily lovely little planet. And this is surely remarkable. But we do so much else besides. For example, we make language. Language that fires and challenges our imagination, I would say. Language that makes us conscious of the worlds within us and beyond us." And so we return to that question I posed at the start. Can non-religious and avowedly atheist writing from the modernist period and forward, can these participate in that Christian literary imagination as we've defined it? We'll consider by way of chiastic return how the natural beauty of a beech grove inspired that post-Christian poet Joan Maragall to write his poem La Fageda d'Enjorda, and the consonant concrescence, if you will, of awe that it induces in the stroller who walks through that trove, the grove of trees. For Maragall, the beech tree canopy serves as a beautiful enclosure, ultimately like a prison. His poem ends, "The stroller forgets the rest of the world in the silence of that deep place and does not think about leaving or going. He is grasped by the beech grove of Jorda, prisoner of silence and greenery." Maragall's stroll has made the exodus into material beauty, but could not manage to find his way back out of his verdant prison. Yet this same forest, La Garrocha, inspired the proudly Catholic Antoni Gaudí to put natural beauty at the center of his church, precisely because his vision of the natural world does not compete with the theological framework beyond the interior. That aging writer Julian Barnes recognizes the confines of his mortal coil and the felt enclosure of mortality awakens for him questions of what lies outside of the visible and the experiential. I'd say that the challenge for Christian theologians among us, for us here today and in this year, is to take seriously the questions posed by those literary writers who are not or seem not to be part of the Christian tradition. They describe sometimes searingly the psychological strictures of interiority. They feel the pressing in of a closed ontological frame, one that does not admit of God or anything beyond the visible. We might see this as only one leg of William Lynch's Christian imaginative movement, a descent into the immanent, an exitus without a reditus, a return to God. If theologians can learn to speak in different registers, to see how our language of religious experience might play away from home, as Rowan Williams terms it, then we must be interested to consider architecture and poetry and music in addition to Christian literature. And the Christian imagination has this to offer: a world that is wary of religious affiliation. We can show the literary world that there are other ways of deploying beautiful language by speaking not just around God, but with God and to God. And if we open our windows to what is beyond us, we might find God's light ready to shine through our canopies, painting the darkened forests within us. Thank you.
Well, thanks very much, Joe, for that. That some questions have come in, and can I ask you this one from Joe? For Joe, it says, Christian metaphors and analogies are incredibly compelling, but at what point do they become so compelling that they lose spiritual value and become simply literary? Or does it matter?
That's a very good question. I suppose much of it depends on what we take to be a metaphor. If we use an expression like the hands on a clock, and we no longer think of them metaphorically as you know, abstractions from our human hands, then they kind of lose their bite as something spoken from away from home. And so part of the, I think, the imagination is to say, how are there ways that we can communicate religious experience in new registers, in new ways? And some of the writers that I was talking about, to think of God as something like a lighthouse who sheds light intermittently, but is not always present in ways that we would expect or hope, is a different way of thinking about it. But I think anytime that the metaphor becomes too familiar, it risks becoming an idol, I think, of God. So that would be a problem, I would say.
Can I ask you another one, Joe? Because it's just come out from Richard Borgerman. Christians, agnostics, and atheists seem like an overtly narrow categorization as we think about great literary works. One might say that part of Shakespeare's universal appeal is that he thought of spirituality in broader forms, so he could be empathetic and multiple faith traditions, not just Protestant and Roman Catholic, but even pagan. Arguments about whether Shakespeare was Protestant or Catholic strike me as yet another false binary. Well, I certainly agree with that, but what do you think, Jeff?
Well, I mean, I'll speak briefly and then I'll pitch it over to you to discuss Shakespeare. I think one of the things that William Lynch is pointing out is that, again, it's not just a matter of speaking in religious terms, but any piece of great fiction will engage with the concrete particulars of human experience. And so it'll be interested in Christians and non-Christians, believers and non-believers alike. And so there's sort of an interest in that which is real, that which is human. I think of that line from Terence, I'm human and nothing human is alien to me. I think that resonates with the Christian imagination without kind of baptizing fiction necessarily, but recognizing that God's grace might be operative beyond the visible confines of, you know, explicitly religious literature. I don't know, what do you think about that vis-a-vis Shakespeare?
Well, I think in terms of Shakespeare and tragedy, we're at a point at the moment in which people are starting to question some of the traditional binary issues that they have imposed upon some of the tragedies, you know? So I started by talking about Dr. Faustus or about Macbeth. Grotowski talks about Dr. Faustus as being a saint, using a Christian word, but as being a saint because he's rebelling against, he says, against the tyranny of God. And there's a kind of a rich ambiguity going on here within Marlowe, and also within Shakespeare, within Macbeth, for example. Some of the most recent work on Macbeth is saying, let's just have a look at this. Why did Macbeth revolt in the first stage? What was going on? So they take on the story imaginatively to ask, was Duncan this good king, or was he not a good king? He stands aside when all the battles are going on, and Macbeth's doing that. He's a professional killer. When he's a professional killer, Macbeth is a hero, rewarded and so on. But when he kills Duncan, he's suddenly a traitor. So you're starting to get there, this kind of Renaissance questioning about language and about the instability of truth. And I think that it continually within Shakespeare, we're coming back to what is truth at an age when there is, a binary going on contextually in the historical context of Protestant against Catholic and one executed or the other executed for their sincerity of their faith. But this question goes beyond that to where do we find truth and how do we find truth and what is truth now that something has collapsed in a sense through the nature of the Reformation, something has collapsed. Though that links to another question that came in earlier that says, which is asking really is the literature of the period, the medieval period, merely being orthodox because you are having to write in those ways, or is it sincerely felt? Was the doubt? Of course there was doubt. There is always doubt. But of course it wasn't actually expressed in the way that doubt might be expressed now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, part of that question too, I think, gets at, how much of, I'll read it even before secularization and the political pressures of the Renaissance, I wonder how much of the Christian literature reflected sincere belief versus political pressure or concerns, or is it impossible for us to know? You've kind of spoken about, this is sort of a robust Christian world, so you wouldn't name those doubts back then, but how much of do you think the vision was shaped by political pressures apart from religious concerns?
Well, it's the political, how do you separate the political and the religious? Where what we find is that authority is the authority of God, and the authority of God is embodied in the ruler, within the king. And therefore, when you get to analyze that, of course it is imposed, it is being imposed because it is part of the social order and the power of the ruler. And they use language in order to demonstrate their authority. Mm-hmm. That isn't something which is alien to us, is it? When we have a look at the language and the issues about language, which we're seeing across the Atlantic at the moment, and the talk of fake news and what is true and what is not. Mm-hmm. I think we're going to have to wind it up though, Joe, but one more word from you.
I was going to say, to that point about kind of the ruler embodying God's sovereignty and authority residing with the political ruler, in a time that's more democratic around the world, or sort of a democratizing of power, but also of spiritual authority. And so people kind of leaning into their own experience of things. And that's something that we see in more modernist literature, to the point that sometimes people kind of get caught within their worlds. And Graham Ward, who's my supervisor, and others before him, speak of we're living in a period of kind of a liquid religion, that the religious impulse or that kind of longing for something deeper or some deeper meaning doesn't disappear in a secular age. And what does it even mean to say a secular age? But that it just becomes more fragmented, kind of more democratic. And so people are going to be looking for religious experiences in ways different from ones that were enforced in the past, say, where you'd have the church and state more closely allied. And even Virginia Woolf was pushing against sort of the Victorian sensibilities that she saw, that those all needed to be kind of wiped away, that she said somewhere around the year December of 1910, human nature changed. We might say 2020, there's a kind of a radical shift as well, but seeing at that point kind of an inflection point where people were learning to trust more in their experience to the exclusion of received authority in church or in state. So,
great. Well, I've enjoyed your talk as well, Joe, today, and the discussion and the questions that have come in. Can we please note that the next talk in the series will be on the 27th of October with Dr. Peter Davidson, who will be speaking on Robert Southwell's poetry, which is recently edited for the Oxford University Press. Would you also note that on the 19th of October, we have a special Zoom event in the future of the Humanities Project, as well as a Freedom of Speech Project at Georgetown. Is there a threat to free speech worldwide? It's a transatlantic dialogue and it features Baroness Mary Gowdy from the UK House of Lords, Ambassador Donald McHenry, former USA Ambassador to the United Nations, Michael Naumann, former director of the German weekly Die Zeit, and Sally Chapathi, Chair of Writers in Prisons Committee at Penn International, with moderators being Sanford Ungar, the director of the Freedom of Speech Project at Georgetown, and myself. So I hope you might join us for those two events. For now, thanks again to you, Joe, for your help and your pertinent paper, and which has stimulated, I think, the rest of the series. Thanks to all those who have submitted questions. We will try to answer any questions that we haven't answered today. Thanks to all at Georgetown University who have made this happen, especially Yvonne Quek and colleagues working to make Zoom possible. Special thanks to Professor Catherine Temple at Georgetown for her work in feeding questions to us. At Blackfriars, my thanks to Dr. Richard Finn, director of the Las Casas Institute, and Dr. John O'Connor, our new regent, as well as Kinga Rona Gabnai, our administrator. At Georgetown, my thanks as always to Dr. Jack DeJoya, the president, Dr. Tom Banchoff, the vice president of global affairs, and Dr. Chris Chalenza, dean of Georgetown College. Finally, my thanks to you for being part of our audience. Join us please on the 19th and 27th of October. And in the meantime, take care and keep safe. I'm Mike Scott. Please follow me on Twitter at Mike Scott Prof. Thanks and goodbye.